Bravo. Thank you, Amy Goodman, for your continual recruitment of wonderful people to ring our morning bells. And thanks to everyone who believes in yourself the way Amy believes in you. Really happy to be with you all on this Sunday morning in the brick and mortar and in the Zoom room. Chris, you want to get us started?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, friends, I just want to offer a welcome to everyone, and especially offer a welcome to those of us who are visiting, with the visitors in our midst, especially if it is your first time here. There are prayer cards in the pews. There are also welcome pads. If you don't know the person sitting next to you and you pass that pad to them, look at the pad. Ask them, say hello by name. Get to know each other. We're grateful you're here.
Also, my favorite introduction is to say, I think I knew you before the pandemic, but I might need
your
name now that the pandemic
is grace abounds.
Yeah. So we are very excited to draw your attention to a board in the back of the narthex. It is for the second semester of Parker Lucas's art project, which is the main reason for his residency among us. And on that board, there are cards. And they are cards of invitation with a QR code that will provide people the information they might need. But what we're looking for is a group of about 12. And we think to find 12 interested people, we'll need to circulate about 40 or 50 of these cards. So if you have friends in your life that you would like to invite to Parker's semester project with the arts, we would really appreciate your help. I'll be taking 3 of these and giving them to 3 of my friends, and so want to invite you to do the same. All of this is a great introduction to bringing art projects by January 31st to be included in this year's art show. So with that, Chris?
Yeah. And friends, as we usually do, if you have your bulletin, I'm just going to direct your gaze to this page. Props to Shane Montoya, who week after week makes this page look fabulous. And there's a ton of information on here about what's coming up next. There's a looking ahead section that kind of keeps your eye attuned to maybe next month, kind of what's more down the road. But check it out. We would love for you to get involved as you would like.
One of the specific announcements that we have is for the Light and Lampstand group.
Yes.
This is the new group for members who are just have joined the congregation in the year 2020 and 2021. The first event of that small group will be in my home on Thursday, DJ and I's home on my home. What a slip up. on Thursday evening. There's no pressure to attend, but we wanted to let you know that that was still going to happen in these days of uncertainty. One additional announcement is that we will be doing in the Weaving Science and Faith class a book study on braiding sweetgrass, which we'll be using about 7 chapters from this book, 7 brief chapters. It's Native American spirituality that has a strong connection to scripture, and it'll be on the subject of love. So books are available outside my office if you're interested in that opportunity. Chris, does that wrap it up for us?
That's it. We're good.
So we want to remind you that this week we will have the privilege of celebrating 2 lives of 2 congregants in this church. Bob Young's life will be celebrated Tuesday at 2 o'clock here in the sanctuary, and Amelia Sutterth's life will be celebrated Friday at 1 o'clock in the sanctuary with a graveside following at Oakwood. We're very happy for Isaac and Christine Turpin, who were married in the sanctuary Friday morning and are beginning their married life together.
A shout out to Diane Tisdale, who was hospitalized this last week. I think she spent several days in the ER because there's no room in the local hospitals. And then to Sarah Preddy, who's still recovering at the Temple Hospital.
You and I arrive to the strength of the font. It's our comfort, it's the calling that begins with our baptism. And by the font, we welcome one another each and every week, saying, "Welcome home, children of God."
Friends, will you rise in body or in spirit for our call to worship? We arrive to Christ's church through open doors. Come as we are. The threshold is wide enough for our shackles and weights. We arrive to the Spirit's church through open doors. Within a sanctuary, we seek a deep and abiding freedom that allows us to receive each other as we are and provide service to each other in God's name. We arrive to First Presbyterian through open doors that we may walk upright and with humility all week long in the presence of our Creator. Let us worship our God who sees us from exile to freedom in mysterious and abiding ways. Amen.
Seated. Friends, Scripture teaches us that there is no fear in love, and in fact, that love casts out fear. And so again, week by week, we come to the throne of grace, trusting again that God loves us, so that whatever fears might be bubbling up inside of us for this week, that God's love might cast them out once again. And so let's join together in our prayer of confession. God of latitudes and longitudes, we confess our sense of distance. There are portions of the world that seem too far from us to matter. Circumstances that seem too foreign. There are people who seem worlds away. We confess our sense of distance. And yet you are the God of proximity and imminence. We trust in the way you bridge the distance and energize across gaps. You are our God of matrix and connection. Though there is distance, there is also shared identity. In your presence, our actions ripple through the tie that binds us together in the spirit. And like a massage, we are reminded that you are not far away, but deep within and between. Hear our confession and prayers for wisdom. In and through Christ we pray. Amen. Friends, let peace permeate every part of you this morning and hear this word that because of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. And so rise and share a sign of peace with those gathered around, saying, "The peace of Christ be with you."
Peace of Christ.
Peace of Christ.
Peace of Christ, everyone. Good morning.
Peace of Christ, everyone.
Peace of Christ.
Peace of Christ, everyone.
As we continue greeting one another, let's sing our children forward for a little time together.
Christ before me, Christ behind me, Christ beside me, Christ within me, Christ in the space of those who love.
Oh my gosh, I'm so excited to have the three of you up here. Mila, how are you, honey? Oh, there you are, JJ. Be seated, everyone. Be comfortable. Mila, I'm so excited you're here because I don't think you have a spirit box yet. And I want you to have a personal spirit box. So will you come with me? These around the cross are personal spirit boxes that have been made by wood turners in Miami County. Phil Herring, please raise your hand. Phil Herring got this organized for us. And so, Karina, Mila needs to pick out a spirit box that she can keep by her bed. And she can do that anytime. She does not have to do that right now. So she might want to pick one out. Oh, that looks like a good one. Yeah, let's bring it. You guys have your spirit boxes? Yeah. Let's see what Mila put in the spirit box for us this morning. Oh, look at this. This is a beautiful doll. Did this doll come from a special place, Karina?
From a friend.
From a friend. And so does the doll have a name?
It's a
Frida doll, one of the most, can we call her an eccentric artist? Yeah, eccentric and daring. And one of the things that I love about Frida is one of the things I don't love about myself, which is the big forehead. I have a big forehead. We're gonna talk about that. And then this looks like a little house to me. What's in there, Lola? Little bunnies. Oh my gosh. Mila, look at, I mean, in the spirit of bunnies, they just keep coming. It's wonderful. It's a little house of three bunnies. It kind of reminds me of the Malavante home with three precious people of super high energy in them. Do you guys like rabbits or do they kind of freak you out? You love them. Why do you love them? Oh, you love their speed. That makes sense. Ryan, do you like rabbits? You never thought about it before this moment, have you? Yeah. Lola, how about you? What do you love about them? They really do give chase. One of the things that I love is that they're soft. And touching a soft thing makes me feel soft. But I am really struck not only by the simple beauty of this mouse home, but by the extraordinary timing of putting an artist in the spirit box when we are getting ready to celebrate the art of the congregation. Mila, did you just devise that in your brain all by yourself? I love it. One of the things that Frida was very good at was being brave. She had to be brave because she had some differences in her body that made people look at her differently. Yeah, she had to be brave because she was a woman in a man's industry, and she had to be brave because she saw the world like nobody else did. And one of the things that I want to point out, Mila, is that sitting in the front row with her mom, Lillian, would you just step up here? I know you're too old to be a kid, but I really have to bring you up on the matter of an artist. Absolutely, absolutely. What this young woman does every week is she draws the sermon as she understands it. And on the very first time you handed me your picture of the sermon, you said, "I don't know if it's right." And then you looked back at me and you said, "I guess that's not really the point, that it would be right. It can't be wrong, my understanding." And so Lillian Goodman draws the sermon and shows me how she sees the world in light of the stories out of the Bible. I love it. Do you want to put her to bed? Night, night, Frida. Yeah, that would be dangerous. I might keep her. Wonderful. Well, we continue to enjoy discovering how you guys see the world. Shall we say our prayer together? You want to help me help them with the prayer? Let's stand up so everyone can see us. Wave at the camera. God be in my head. God be in my heart. God be on my left. God be on my right. God be beneath me. God be above me. God be in the faces of all who love me. Amen. Thank you, guys. Wonderful box. Can you get up? Okay. Love it. Love, love, love it.
Friends, before our Hebrew scripture reading today, will you join me in a word of prayer? God of longitudes and latitudes, you help guide us. You help illumine the way that lies before us. Sometimes it's dark, sometimes it's rainy. Sometimes it's snowing and we don't know which way to go. In the midst of our turning minds and the constant road signs that might lead us astray, you are there. Your presence is right next to us. And in these moments where we come to sit still before you, you are right there. And allow these words said and sung to illumine in our hearts. Amen. So today, our scripture reading comes from 2 Kings chapter 25, verses 27 through 30. So I would like your help real quick. There are two very hard names that come up in this passage. So one, I might need Leslie's help with real quick. So we have Jehoiakim and
Ewell-Merodach.
Ewell what?
Merodach.
Ewell-Merodach. Can y'all repeat that with me? Ewell-Merodach. Okay. And then
looks like evil, but the Hebrew softens that, what would be a V for us.
Yes. So if I get it wrong, y'all repeat it back at me if need be. So listen now for the word of the Lord. In the 37 years of the exile of King Jehoiakim of Judah, in the 12th month, on the 27th day of the month, King Ewell-Merodach of Babylon, in the year that he began to reign, releases King Jehoiakim of Judah from prison. He spoke kindly to him and gave him a seat above the other seats of the kings who were with him in Babylon. So Jehoiakim put aside his prison clothes. Every day of his life, he had dined regularly in the king's presence. For his allowance, a regular allowance, was given to him by the king, a portion every day as long as he lived. This is the word of the Lord.
Friends, would you please rise for the reading of the gospel? This morning, we're reading from St. John's account, chapter 14, verses 18 through 24. Listen for God's word. I will not leave you orphaned, for I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. And on that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me, and those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them. Judas, but not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will reveal yourself to us and not to the world? And Jesus answered him, those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but is from the Father who sent me. Friends, the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Glory be to the Father, and to
the effort of the sermon series has been to refresh ourselves on the persistence of the image of exile in Scripture, the effect that it has on the gospel. So we looked at the Exodus out of Egypt. We looked at the Garden of Eden narrative and the suggestion of being exiled from ease to work. We looked at then the later exile that the Assyrian Empire imposes upon the Israelites, removing them from their religious center. And we look now at a second exile by the Empire of Babylon. Second Kings 25 brings up a poignant reality in exile. That it was not just the Israelites, nor is it today just individuals who lack power or resource who experience displacement and exile. Second Kings 25 notes very poignantly that exile also included kings and those in power. So permit me a minute to give you the backstory on Jehoiakim and Ehil Marduk. Yeah. The backstory is this. Jehoiakim is the king of Judah at the age of 18. And he rules 3 years before he is confronted by King Nebuchadnezzar in Jerusalem. And King Jehoiakim of Judah forfeits and surrenders to this Babylonian King Nebuchadnezzar. King Nebuchadnezzar imprisons Jehoiakim for 37 years. Meanwhile, the state officials of Babylon do not prefer Nebuchadnezzar initially. They prefer Ehil Marduk. Ehil Marduk is placed as ruler supreme and contested by Nebuchadnezzar, who throws Ehil Marduk in prison. You see, 2 Kings 25 shows us that two competing kings have something in common. They have both been imprisoned, and for different reasons. They have both been exiled from the power and the authority.
2 Kings 25 shows us poignantly that when we consider exile, we are to consider all the strata of society. So when 2 Kings 25 says that Evil-Marduk spoke kindly to Jehoiachin, what that means is they cut a treaty between themselves. And that Evil-Marduk made space for this Judean king, gave him an allowance, brought him out of exile, gave him a place. Nothing short of restoring identity. Speaking of identity, some in the world of sociology indicate, I'm having a bit of a fearful moment because I think I removed my own sticky note. Some in the world of sociology have said that identity and social change have really come at a tremendous cost. Let me say that sentence again. Some in the realm of sociology assert that in our current culture, our identities are really at stake, our fundamental identities. So give me a moment of privilege to read a brief paragraph to you. This is from a scholar from the University of Leeds in Warsaw, the sociologist Zygmunt Bauman. Nowadays, we are on the move. We change places. We move homes. We're traveling to and from places that are not our homes. We are all on the move, even when we stay physically put. While glued to a chair, we zip between cable and satellite channels with a speed much beyond the capacity of supersonic jets and cosmic rockets. We stay nowhere long. We flit through the web, netting and mixing one computer screen message born in opposite corners of the globe. In the world we inhabit, distance doesn't matter much. It exists as if solely to be canceled out. It offers a constant invitation to traverse. It has stopped being an obstacle. One needs but a split second to conquer distance. Thus, there are no natural boundaries anymore. Whatever we happen to be at, wherever we happen to be at the moment, we cannot help knowing that we could be someplace else. And it relegates us to the identity of tourists or vagabonds. Now, there's a reason I'm stopping with the first paragraph, because the article does not brighten up. Even in its dim view of our circumstances, I find it remarkably astute. Because I myself have had the phone by my lap while I switch between two movies, waiting for those scenes that I just love to watch again and again, only to mute the remote control and pick up my phone when the awaited-for call arrives. I think this opening article of a book entitled Social Identity and Change is astute. Because on the matter of exile, the extent to which we experience it may be compromised by his observation that we are so easy to traverse and get someplace else. So that we might even miss the exilic experience as we move from one age to another. We might even be able to distract ourselves from the exile of our own power as we age and mature in life, shifting to another space. And the only reason this matters is that if we ignore the exiled feeling,
It affects our behavior. It affects our ability to love our life. And the older we get, the more we realize that life needs us, our life needs us to love it. The broad horizons of our youth narrow to a focus as we attend to our mortality. And our life sort of whines in the most insistent way. Do you love me? Second Kings and John 14 mean to punctuate a truth that you and I, within the particularity of our own life, can experience an exile that is not imposed by others, but sometimes chosen by ourselves as we move through the ages and the stages of life. But I do not agree with the sociologist Bowman on the dismal reality in which we have very little choice. There are two important words in all the congested words of John 14, orphan and reveal. I have not orphaned you. I mean, you live long enough, and there are times when you feel like an orphan. I have not orphaned you, and I will reveal to you, and the revelation will come as love. But oh my goodness, if there is a word that I cannot stand to speak from the pulpit, it is the word love. For it has become something of a pallid piece of rhetoric or propaganda in the Christian faith. So I didn't enjoy the task of attending to the word that has been watered down to, you know, notions of politeness or good and positive feelings. The reason I don't agree with Bowman is that 2 Kings and John 14 say, you are neither tourist nor vagabond. You are the children of God who are endowed and allowed a royal presence. You are not just tourists or vagabonds. You are the children of God endowed and allowed with a royal presence. And royal presence means you represent more than you know. Royal presence means you represent more than you know. And that is an act of love. My go-to scholar on emotions is Karen McLaren. My therapist recommended the book to me. It is an excellent book, The Language of Emotions. It indexes all conceivable constellations of emotions. And in the middle of the book, she says, by the way, love is not an emotion. She said, your emotions will rise and fall. Your emotions will ebb and flow. Your emotions can be controlled. Love exists like a foundation. Love exists whether we engage it or not. We can be afraid of, fearful for, and resentful toward the people we love. She says to me when I read her book, if you want a book that talks about love as emotion, pick another author. She says it. I'm going to get on with talking about emotions, and I will not be talking about love. What then is love? I think love is a royal presence representing more than you know. And Our passage from 2 Kings has beautiful micro adjustments between Eli, Marduk, and Jehoiakim. Eli, Marduk pulls him out of prison, and Jehoiakim sets his prison clothes aside. Now, that is a strong and a powerful sentence. It says to the exiled Leslie King, you know, pick her exile. Exile from Kansas. Exile from active parenting of kids who are interested. Right? Pick her exile. It says to the exiled Leslie King, there are ways in which you can be present royally, but you must set your prison clothes aside. You must set aside those things that declare you to have been exiled. Pick the exile of old age, and you get to define what that is. We live in one doozy of a culture on old age, and we are almost the only culture that pulls the punches. Maybe it's that our culture is young enough that we still flirt around with the idea that the truth of old age is that you're losing it, you're on your way out, you're only going to be competent for a little while longer, and you're a has-been. Does it sound familiar? I mean, it's a prison. It's a prison in our own mind. It'll make us crazy. And it has really intelligent human beings second-guessing themselves all the time. Second Kings says, if you're the exiled one and you've got royal power, the first thing you do is you set your prison clothes aside and you get garbed up in the royalty that is yours, God-given. Let me substantiate it. If you choose to follow Jesus Christ, Lamb on the throne, you are a representative of more than you know. You are a royal presence in the world. The second move is that there is a treaty of agreement. And this is really where love is, this is really where McLaren's understanding of love comes through. A treaty says, I've got to be careful with you because you've got power. A treaty says, this is how we're going to behave together. Not to make each other happy, but for the well-being of the entire community. The morale of the masses is why one king gives another king access to the throne room. And practically, this plays out because you and I catalyze each other's emotions. We say things and do things that freak each other out, that worry each other, that make us jubilant or over the moon. I mean, our emotions are engaged all the time by one another. But that isn't love. That's affection. Love says, how will we mobilize the worry? How will we mobilize the joy? How will we mobilize the critique for the greater good? Oh, and now love is deep and wide, and it's not just about being nice or polite or trying to please each other. It's about making God's world a stronger place by investing our perspective, our royal presence. Nothing competes with the exile like making a treaty with the world around you. No greater love than when one lays down one's life for one's friends. It's more than bringing casseroles and writing love notes. When our friends are afraid because they have been exiled by their circumstances, love is not woe is you and woe is me. Love is, oh, there is potential and promise. I see it. You can do it. Love shows up ready to gear up. The final move, I mean, I really have to confess that I think 2 Kings 25, 27 to 30, now rivals Exodus 16 as my favorite passage of Scripture. Jehoiakim gets a daily allowance, like daily bread to spend. And so you and I arrive to our priestly presence against any tourism, against any inclination that we are simply wandering vagabonds. We get a daily allowance of eye contact and smiles and language and limbs to spend ourselves out in the world to do the only thing that love can do, which is to be present in the moment. To say to our own life, I love you. Just like you are. For all that could have been, should have been, I love you. It's the equipment that allows us then to catapult to the end of the Gospel of John where Jesus implores, do you love me? Feed my sheep. And if you've ever fed a sheep, which Lorraine Dupuy right now is currently doing with her husband, Carr, it is messy. It is not pleasant. It is not a Valentine's card. This compass, this royal presence, this love that Christ really believes we are competent to deploy is the ultimate competitor to the exile. May God bless us as we navigate. Amen.
Please rise in body or spirit for the singing of our hymn.
Thank you.
Friends, you may be seated. Thank you. Love always yields generosity. For the one who knows what it is to receive love can't help but be grateful. And so with that said, I'm going to invite our ushers forward as we receive our morning tithes and offerings.
Let us pray. Gracious God, from the depths of the ocean to the depths of the human gut, our prayers are with those who are trying to discover their purpose, their identity within places of constriction and pressure. For civic and political leaders, for teachers in classrooms, Lord, we trust in the ways you hear our prayer. O God of the heights of mountains and trees and the very top and front of the human brain, we are mindful for all of the ways that we are reaching through science and technology, through the expansion of our colonization to the cosmos. Be with those in laboratories. Be with those in research and writing, that their light may illumine broad and wide. God of the human heart, of the highways and byways of our nation, we are mindful of all who are traveling with intention to arrive in right ways. Traveling mercies, may they be theirs. Lord of the ground beneath our feet, it feels stable, and yet we are aware that deep the earth shifts and moves. Bless our agility, our observant minds and hearts, that we may be responsive and loving. God of Christ, from the height to the depth, the breadth of all creation, we offer again the prayer that he set in motion, saying with one voice, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends, before you receive your charge and benediction, I just want to extend a welcome to all of you who feel comfortable. There will be snacks, goodies, drinks in the Foundation Parlor right over here immediately following worship. Many thanks to, where are they, Mike and Kathy? Where are y'all? Oh, they're probably out there already. Say thank you when you go see them. Hear this charge. Go out into the world in peace. Be people of courage, people of hope. Render no one evil for evil, but instead safeguard the helpless. Support the weak. Nurture those who are afflicted. Love and serve the Lord your God, rejoicing always in the power of the Holy Spirit.
Friends, you can do all of this and more because of our Redeemer, Sustainer, and God. Amen.
Amen.
So good. Listen, doing my best. Don't look too close.
Good. Have a